Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 11153 in the name of Claire Adamson on behalf of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee on culture in communities, the challenges and opportunities in delivering a place-based approach. I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Claire Adamson to speak to and to move the motion on behalf of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. Ms. Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I am delighted to open this debate as convener of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. I would like to put on record my thanks to our clerks for the work in organising this inquiry. And I also want to thank those who took part in our lunchtime event to highlight the report. We're joined in the gallery by representatives who took part in the evidence sessions, including Quail Arts Centres, Museums Association, Museums Galleries Scotland, Creative Lives and Art 27. And we also had performances for those delivering on some of the projects. So we welcome as well Recovery Scotland and North Lanarkshire Recovery Band with Real Time Music, Culture Collective Representative John Martin Fulton, Storytelling Centre Representative and again part of the Culture Collective Jane Mathers, and Shot Spotlight, who are with us in the gallery today, so we welcome them. I'm delighted to open the debate and our inquiry considered the important matter of access to culture within communities, because as we heard, for many people, participation in culture within their community is, quote, what their cultural life looks like. It's being part of a local choir, a book club or a drama group. It's going along to a makeshift cinema in a town hall or library, setting up an open mic night or joining in the gallery. Scotland is, of course, a culturally rich nation. And so it is important to ensure that communities right across Scotland have the opportunity to participate in and enjoy cultural activities. And not only just to participate, but to be empowered to shape the cultural life of their place, their community. And for organisations delivering cultural interventions in community to truly understand and respond to the unique needs of those communities. Indeed, the Scottish Government's culture strategy is clear that giving people a greater say in the shaping of cultural life in their communities can help protect Scotland's cultural heritage. This gets to the nub of place-based approach to culture, which is a key focus for the culture strategy, and it builds on long-standing ambitions to adopt community-led approaches to service delivery. Our report considered the challenges and opportunities in delivering this place-based approach to culture. I'd like to thank again all the organisations who submitted evidence to the inquiry or took part in our visits, or who took part in roundtables that we held during the course of the inquiry. And for those who facilitated and participated in our engagement visits to the communities in Wester Hales, Craigmillar, Dumfries and Orkney. This rich evidence helped inform our inquiry and the findings of our report. We had countless positive examples of this place-based cultural work being delivered in communities. We saw firsthand the transformative impact local cultural projects are having, including on regeneration, on creative placemaking, and particularly in the support of wellbeing. But our report also identified several challenges facing both national and local government in delivering this approach. These challenges, Presiding Officer, which must be addressed to realise the ambition of the cultural strategy. The Deputy Convener will expand on some of these challenges in his closing remarks, but I'd like to begin with the importance of supporting the vital role of voluntary arts. We heard that the vast majority of cultural activities in communities is dependent on the efforts of volunteers. And we saw this in action in our visit to Orkney, where we met with the volunteer-run cultural groups and the backbone of Orkney's cultural life. We heard of the immense commitment from the community to make cultural activity happen, but also the challenge in volunteer fatigue and burnout. And we know that not all communities have the time and resources to volunteer. Given the vital role of volunteers in sustaining local culture, we are concerned about the impacts of these inequalities and opportunities for cultural participation. So we also heard calls for there to be greater support for the voluntary arts. With capacity building, regular microgrant funding for voluntary groups. And we've asked the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland to explore whether further support can be provided, in particularly to the communities with fewer resources. If I could turn to the wider challenge of funding, this was central to the evidence that we received. The long-standing financial challenges facing the culture sector, which have been intensified in recent years, have been well documented. Indeed, our own pre-budget report published last week found that the, quote, perfect storm facing the sector has not abated over the last 12 months. We heard that these wider budgetary pressures were constraining funding for cultural organisations to deliver place-based projects and activities, for local government cultural services and publicly owned community spaces where cultural activity takes place. These funding constraints pose a significant challenge to the successful delivery of the culture policy. Community-based cultural projects need to be embedded in the longer term to be successful. But this work often relies on short-term and volatile project funding. Indeed, we heard the phrase donut funding being mentioned, in that quite often a project would be funded, but not the infrastructure and the organisational funding that's needed to support these individual projects. We heard the cultural collective programmes had been a powerful example of a nation-based, place-based initiative which had supported cultural organisations and artists to work in partnership with communities and develop local projects. And that this had benefited from being funded at scale over a two-year period. Stella Quine said that the programme had enabled them to show how it could be and what it might be possible if the necessary funding was available to deliver this work on an ongoing basis. But the funding for the programme is concluding. The Scottish Government should now set out how its legacy will be built upon to the future place-based initiatives and the new cultural strategy. On our visit to Wheel Arts in Western Isles, we heard of, as mentioned, the donut funding, which this supports delivery, but not the overheads from having a building or from the infrastructure needed to support an organisation to do administrative and planning work. A significant challenge for organisations was trying to deliver long-term transformative work. So who within the funding landscape should cover these overheads? This is a question we think needs further consideration. And we believe that there needs to be clearer understanding of the respective roles of national and local government funding for community-based culture, in both supporting the activity itself, but also the infrastructure underpinning it. Presiding Officer, the emphasis on the role of communities and place and culture strategy is very welcome. In practice, there still needs to be much greater prioritisation of the role of community culture at the heart of the cultural sector as a whole, in recognition that for many people, their cultural participation within their communities is perhaps the only cultural activity in which they will take part. We invite the Scottish Government to consider whether community-based culture should be funded separately from professional arts and they shouldn't be seen as on a parity. And I note in the response from the Scottish Government that this model will be taken into consideration moving forward. Local government too has an essential role to play, but the ongoing funding challenges it faces are leading to real-term reduction in spend on local cultural activities, often seen as a low-hanging fruit. And we're concerned about the impact that this could have on the delivery of services in community. Culture Trust Glasgow Life said the health of local government finances is having a direct impact on the funding available for services it provides. And Community Leisure said any reductions in spending culture will now result in reduction in provision as all other saving mechanisms had been already implemented and considered. And the Museums Association said that it could lead to local authorities limiting cultural provision or removing free access to culture. National and local government need to work in partnership to assess the ongoing impact of the fiscal environment.
Sorry to interrupt, but I think the time allocated is 9 minutes.
Oh, I beg your pardon, Presiding Officer.
We don't have any time in hand.
On that note, I will conclude and I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Ms Adamson. I now call on Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson. Up to 8 minutes, please, Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to be here today to hear from colleagues across the Chamber around how we harness the opportunities and rise to the challenges of place-based cultural provision, and pay tribute to all members of the committee for their report. One of our ambitions in the Scottish Government is to meet communities' economic, physical and social needs, ensuring sustainability and supporting well-being. So culture and creativity are a vital part of this, and our ambition for everyone to experience the transformative potential of culture is one of the key pillars of our culture strategy. We're very alive to the fact that this is an incredibly challenging time for the sector. The enduring shocks of Brexit fallout, the pandemic, the energy crisis, and the mismanagement of the economy by the UK government have sent prices spiralling, and we've had to make incredibly difficult decisions in light of these financial challenges. However, we've prioritised support for culture, and I was delighted yesterday to report that the Scottish Government has released £6.68 million worth of funding to the culture sector for the rest of this financial year. This funding comprises of £1.5 million to the Culture Collective programme, about which we've heard so much already, £2 million to Screen Scotland, £250,000 to the Platform for Creative Excellence, £130,000 to the National Performing Companies Touring Fund, and £2.8 million to fund public sector pay policy uplifts. Now, this funding will support individuals and communities across Scotland via our funding to the Culture Collective programme, but it's also a demonstration of our continued investment in screen and in festivals. In addition, we've now released £2.6 million to Systema Scotland, delivering on our commitment to ensure that the organisation has the funding that they need this year to continue to deliver their big noise programmes in communities across the country. Separately, and in light of the challenging context we're in, we've been reviewing the actions which support the culture strategy, and while we recognise the aims and ambitions of the strategy are still very relevant, we'll publish a refreshed action plan later this year setting out what we will do to respond to these challenges. And this will include actions on how we'll support culture and creativity in our communities. I've already mentioned that one of the ways we do this is through our support for programmes like Cultural Collective and Systema Scotland, but also through the Youth Music Initiative, support to independent museums, funding of our national bodies and performing companies, and Edinburgh International Festival. We're proud that in spite of ongoing challenges, our funding for culture reaches the grassroots, local, regional, national and international communities. And we cannot understate the value that we place on our cultural and creative organisations and the contribution that they make to the well-being of individuals and communities across Scotland. The First Minister announced last month that the Scottish Government will increase our investment in Scotland's art and culture by £100 million over the next 5 years. And this is a huge vote of confidence in our culture sector and will help protect the sector and the impact that it makes on people's lives. As set out in our 2023-24 budget, around £90 million was allocated to budget lines for Creative Scotland and other arts, for national performing companies, for the Royal and Ceremonial, and for culture and major event staffing. This amount seeks to more than double that funding by 2029. Ministers will take decisions about where the funding is allocated in 24-25 and future years, subject to the outcome of the Scottish budget process and associated approval by the Scottish Parliament. And I've encouraged colleagues and parties across the Chamber, please, to let their views be known in advance of that. The Scottish Government intends to present the draft budget 24-25 to Parliament on Tuesday, the 19th of December 2023. I reiterate the words of the First Minister that we are making a choice to ensure that Scotland's arts and culture are supported to grow at home and be seen across the world. Working in collaboration with the culture sector around this will be absolutely vital. In fact, I've already begun meeting with MSP colleagues and members of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee to discuss the culture funding model, and I welcome ideas from all members and encourage my colleagues to get in touch to share their thoughts around the culture funding model. And I think we are in agreement across the Chamber that collaboration in this respect is key. In October, I was lucky to get to attend a showcase for the Culture Collective programme and see the inspiring work taking place across the network of 26 participatory arts projects, hearing from participants and practitioners about the impact our investment has had on their lives through grassroots, community-developed cultural provision. For example, the Street Level Culture Collective offered a wide range of artistic residencies in the New Gorbals and Govan Hill areas of Glasgow, connecting to communities via local community connector posts and housing associations. And the artists were open to adapting their practice to meet the needs of the communities in which they are based. In the Gorbals alone, residency locations range from the local primary school, youth centre, local community arts clubs to a hair salon, a barber shop, and even a local chippy. Whereas An Lantar Culture Collective project took a completely different approach, developing an intergenerational project with a local museum and a youth club. It was a multi-art form and heritage project where participants explored local stories, geography, history and culture, resulting in the creation of new artwork based on this heritage material. This led to the development of a collective intergenerational picture of the community, detailing what is special to the community about their own area, and highlighting the similarities and differences of the community over time and the generations. I'm proud that we've protected our investment in the programme. Communities have the opportunity to contribute to what they would like to see in their local area in regards to culture, and this brings to life our culture strategy ambition that everybody should be able to experience and take part in culture. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I look forward to hearing the views from members across the Chamber this afternoon, but end where I finish in extending my appreciation to the convener, to other members of the committee for their hard work in drawing up this report, indeed to fellow members of the Chamber who also have a close interest in cultural affairs. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I now call on Alexander Stewart. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's debate provides a welcome opportunity for the Parliament to set the vision for the culture and embedded within our communities. An effective place-based approach should be one which empowers communities to create cultural projects that meet the needs of many communities. In a culturally diverse place such as Scotland, this raises the question of how best to meet these needs, Presiding Officer. On this question, there was broad consensus on what good practice should look like. Dumfries and Galloway Council perhaps gave the best highlight when they talked about cultural participation, meaning that cultural projects should be developed from the bottom up rather than from the top down. In essence, it is only for communities themselves to decide which cultural initiatives they would like to see instead of governing bodies deciding that for them. Community-based cultural organisations are key to a part of achieving this objective. Throughout the inquiry, our committee heard evidence from organisations that were embedded within communities in the long term as far more effective engagement. Ultimately, cultural engagement is indeed a long-term project, and the way to engage with communities should be set out and reflected. We know that funding for these types of organisations are crucial. The Cultural Collective programme has provided important funding for numerous art projects across Scotland, which will and has been much welcomed. As of last month, the funding is now ending, so it is a key recommendation of our committee's report that the Scottish Government should set out whether or not any further funding will be provided. And I note the comments that the Cabinet Secretary has made over the last few days with reference to that funding and how that will be engaged. And I have no doubt the sector will embrace that, but we need to consider what we do in the future. Following the Scottish Government's recent U-turns on cultural funding, now is not the time or even more financial uncertainty within that sector. On this issue, funding more generally, our committee also called for a more innovative approach on the funding of the sector itself. While evidence was conclusive, we heard that such funding of professional organisations, and the evidence is clear that the flexibility that is required by these organisations is the area that they required and they talked about. On one issue, the Stove Network highlighted that the current system forced community-based culture projects to compete with others in that community, and they are of different structures and of different structure and of different types, and that at sometimes caused some conflict. Creative Lives spoke about the cultural funding streams that are more effective and when the scope is flexible and open to projects. Several stakeholders have also talked about multi-year funding settlements, which are vitally important to play a part in the potential funding reforms. The Scottish Government should listen to the sector that it's telling them some of these issues, because they understand how to manage it and they want to be supported, but they also want the Scottish Government to take on board their concerns at this time. It is time for the Government to come good on the talks about potential reforms with reference. The sector have reformed themselves and continue to do so, but they want the Scottish Government to be supportive of some of the reforms that they've brought forward and work collectively, and I look forward to seeing if that will happen. Presiding Officer, another key theme to the committee's work on the issue was around community assets. Potential cultural venues that we know include many spaces. That could be a village hall, it could be a library, or it could be churches within our communities. The committee heard throughout the inquiry that there are currently various potential threats to many of these cultural assets. Communities therefore sometimes feel under pressure to rescue some of these venues that are at risk within their communities, and many have taken them on board. While it is a large responsibility for community groups to acquire these venues, it is only right that they should be empowered to do so with understanding the circumstances. It was back in 2015 that the Community Empowerment Act came into part, and bodies and organisations are working to ensure that that takes place. With the power having been affected since 2017, there are still much to do for communities to benefit from these potential community asset transfers. While community groups are often fully aware of their legal rights to acquire assets, in practice, many groups are still finding it a little bit bureaucratic to manage to take on board some of that. Some public bodies are still focused entirely on the monetary value when it comes to what these assets should be doing. There are still some cultural shifts required to take full advantage of these assets, and it's important that the Scottish Government work together with councils to ensure that the process is running smoothly and as smoothly as possible. There have been 225 successful asset transfers since the legislation came into force, Presiding Officer. It is clear that the area of great cultural potential, but we have to maximise, and we need to look at how we maximise that potential within our communities. Presiding Officer, it is clear that the Scottish cultural landscape is one that is facing many challenges. It is also clear that this landscape is of great importance to many individuals and to many communities, the length and breadth of Scotland, a landscape which many potential benefits for the communities that they are looking to harness, and they want to be empowered to support and do what they can. It is important that the Scottish Government understands the logistics of that, and working closely with these partnerships and working with these organisations and the councils within Scotland, so that they can work collectively and they can work together to try and embrace that community culture that's vitally important for so many individuals and organisations. I hope the Government is able to approach this the recommendations of our committee's report in good faith and commit to playing its part to protecting this vitally important sector and the vitally important assets that these communities have, because our society depends on it. The Scottish culture is one that is recognised the world over, and communities have their part to play, but the government have their part to play also. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. And I now call on Neil Bibby. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased as both a committee member and on behalf of Scottish Labour to welcome this report, which highlights the benefits of a place-based approach to culture and the many challenges facing its implementation. I believe it's a thorough and carefully considered report, and I extend my sincere thanks to all those who have contributed towards it, the stakeholders who answered the calls for views and provided evidence, and the committee clerks who have done such an excellent job of organising evidence sessions in Edinburgh, Orkney and Dumfries, as well as writing the report. I commend also our convener, Claire Anderson, and fellow members of the committee for their constructive and collegiate approach, and I extend my thanks also to Sarah Boyack, who sat for Scottish Labour on the committee in the early phases. Presiding Officer, well-being, quality of life and physical and mental health are all influenced by the quality of the places we live in. I heard that yet again in a moving testimony this lunchtime from the recovery group from North Lanarkshire about the power of music being used to tackle drug and alcohol addiction. A place-based and community-led approach to service delivery, including in relation to cultural provision, has for some time been recognised as a useful framework, one that recognises that communities themselves ought to be central to the delivery of creative activity within their own areas, to ensure that that activity responds to distinct opportunities and challenges within different localities. And in that spirit, I'd like to pay tribute to organisations such as the Beacon Arts Centre in Greenock, who do tremendous work with young people in Inverclyde. And I'd also like to pay tribute to the Bungalow Bar in Paisley, an outstanding local venue that was recently named Best Music-Led Venue in Scotland at the Scottish Licensed Trade News Awards. Our report notes, however, that despite many positive examples, the proper entrenchment of a place-based approach to culture is inadequate at present, and that is a huge amount of progress is required in order to make it a reality. It identifies a number of challenges for national public bodies and local government in delivering a place-based approach to culture in which communities are central to shaping the cultural life of their place. These challenges are listed in the report as supporting community-based cultural activity, funding culture and communities, providing and supporting local cultural services, and providing and protecting physical spaces and communities for cultural activity to take place in. The report rightly highlights, as has been mentioned, the vital role of volunteers in supporting community-led cultural activity. It is right, however, also to acknowledge that such volunteering is time and resource intensive. As the convener said, the committee was concerned by the evidence that there may be disparities between communities who have greater time and resources to volunteer and those who do not. The committee's view is that it's crucial for all communities across Scotland to be able to shape the cultural life of their places and to sustain the cultural activity which meets their needs. Ensuring that this is likely to involve the Scottish Government in providing funding and support. And the report rightly invites the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland to explore whether further support can be provided to protect and encourage the vital contribution of volunteers to culture in their communities, including the communities with the least resources. The report also highlights the Culture Collective programme as an excellent example of place-based cultural initiative. The committee calls on the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland to set out how its legacy will be built upon. In terms of protecting the future of local physical spaces for cultural activity, the committee also rightly recognises that for culture to thrive within communities, there must be space in which cultural activities can take place, and this is critically important. The committee is therefore concerned by the evidence that has been received that some cultural and community assets are becoming less available, less affordable, and are at risk of closure, including many churches, as Alexander Stewart said, who provide a venue not just for places of worship but places of culture as well. So I too would urge the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland to take all the action it can to protect local cultural spaces. I commend also the committee's suggestion of considering a role for Creative Scotland in delivering a capital programme to support the refurbishment and upkeep of such spaces. In relation to the provision and supporting of local cultural assets, the committee is right to note the essential role of local government in the delivery of place-based approach to culture. The report is right, therefore, to note with concern what it politely terms the funding challenges facing local government. It notes the enforced reduction in cultural spend by local authorities in the face of persistent cuts to council budgets over many years. And I hope the Scottish Government will reflect on that as well as its own spending commitments in the cultural sector. The report also highlights the importance of a joined-up approach between local government and national agencies, and that further progress is required to improve collaboration. I echo the report's call for a further update before the end of the year on what progress has been made on the commitment from the Scottish Government to work with Creative Scotland to map local authorities' support for culture and to explore future models of collaboration between national and local bodies. Finally, Presiding Officer, because I think I need to close, there is a challenge of funding, which is an overarching concern that touches on almost all areas of the report. Cultural activity and cultural life, place-based and otherwise, relies on Scottish Government funding and support. Years of standstill funding and increased costs have created a situation of chronic underfunding and a sector at breaking point. There is an urgent need for investment, support and a new long-term culture strategy. Finally, Presiding Officer, there is also, as many stakeholders highlighted, a need for funding to be placed on a sustainable footing. I commend this report to Parliament and hope we can all work together to ensure we support culture in our communities just now and into the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Bibby. We now move to the open debate. Speeches of up to 6 minutes. I call Keith Brown to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Mr Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should say that I am a member of the committee, but I've not, like the previous speakers, been there during the course of the consideration of the report we're discussing today, so I can't speak with the same authority as those speakers. But I am absolutely on board with the approach. In a culture debate a few weeks ago, I gave a number of examples of organisations which take this approach in my own constituency, as well as stating that, to state the obvious, that we all want to see culture in Scotland thrive, and not just for economic reasons. Those are very important, but also for the difference it can make to people's lives. But we do need to be clear, listening to the last speech, the biggest obstacle in the way of the implementation of many of the recommendations in this report is the extremely limiting financial situation we are in as a country, and the report rightly mentions that. In my view, the current financial restraints facing Scotland are perhaps the starkest we have seen since this Parliament was established. And we need to be really explicit with the people of Scotland. They can all shout about it must be sustainable multi-year funding. If that's not what the Parliament's getting, then how are we going to provide it? Let's be serious about the challenges that we face. And the devolution settlements created a situation where the UK Government still has control over the vast majority of Scotland's finances. And if the UK Government chooses to implement cuts in real terms, as it very often does, then the Scottish Government must make very difficult decisions in order to implement those cuts, either by cutting elsewhere in the Scottish Government's budget or by raising one of the few taxes which the Scottish Government is responsible for, both of which options are virtually always met with universal criticism from the opposition benches. And as for the point about local government, well, local government is obviously constrained, but much less so in Scotland than in England or in Wales. In England, you've had 40% cuts in council budgets. You've had a number of councils going to the wall financially, and we haven't seen that in Scotland. But it is a difficult situation, and we should acknowledge that and the impact it has on a place-based approach to culture. However, the Scottish Government has done and continues to do what it can within the devolution settlement to support a place-based approach to culture in the communities. And I'm also sure that the commitment to double funding for culture and the arts by £100 million over the next 5 years will play a part in furthering this approach. Now, the title of the debate is Challenges and Opportunities. So where I've highlighted the challenges, I'd also like to try and highlight the opportunities. And oddly, one of the side effects of austerity over the last 14 years has been the increase in community ownership of cultural assets, which we've seen across Scotland, and which the report rightly highlights. During this summer alone, I visited Wimpey Park Community Garden in Alawa, which was recently taken over by Wimpey Park Community Group, a group of residents who had a vision and worked immensely hard to bring it to life. And it's a real example, if those on the committee or elsewhere want to visit it, of cultural empowerment in our communities, indeed in one of our most deprived communities. And this is absolutely to be commended. And that's just one of a few examples of my consistency across Clackmannanshire and Dunblane. Thanks to the work usually of immensely dedicated volunteers and community ownership, many formerly publicly owned spaces have taken on new roles in the community. Tullibody Community Trust Development Trust, which operates a civic centre in the town. Dollar Community Development Trust, which operates the Hive in Dollar. Dunblane Development Trust, which manages the Brayport Centre. And perhaps best of all, the Sauchy Community Group, which operates the Sauchy Resource Centre, among many others in my constituency. And all of these are used by their communities as spaces for culture, another important aspect of a place-based approach to culture highlighted in the report. So I welcome the report, and I'd add that one of the most critical aspects of delivering a place-based approach to culture in our communities is by giving the people in those places a significant role in developing and delivering those services. But as a Parliament, we need to be aware of the root causes of the significant financial challenges facing the implementation of the recommendations in this report. And we do not serve the people if we try to ignore the source of those financial constraints. So austerity has been one of the biggest problems, but can I mention another one which was brought home to me today during the committee session that we had with touring musicians, a different category but a very similar challenge. And that was largely Brexit had caused a huge meltdown in that sector. We all heard it, we all heard the evidence. And I asked the participants if the two scenarios that were given about Brexit, one was to have the sunny uplands full of opportunity and no regulation, or the enormous economic and cultural self-harm. And I can tell you it's the latter which characterises their experience since Brexit. And they also said most of the things they're suffering from were predicted at the time of Brexit. And it's honestly, to hear it, what you heard were this decimation of the Scottish cultural sector in that area. You heard some Scottish artists continuing, but only if they could get an Irish passport to appear at Irish events in Germany and elsewhere, not as Scots, but as Irish. That's the only way they could continue. And it was like not an iron curtain, like a theatre curtain coming down on a vitally important part of our cultural heritage. People have lost their jobs, people have walked away from the centre, and that is lost to Scotland. It's an absolute crime that's going on. And they fairly and squarely laid it at the door of Brexit, although made requests, quite really, as you'd expect them to do, in terms of the Scottish Government and what support they can bring as well. But that is the reality of what our cultural sector is going through. And I would hope that when the very welcome news of the additional £100 million from the Government was mentioned, I would endorse some of those people that we heard from today and their request that some of that money finds its way to touring musicians, because it's so important for the international reputation of Scotland. It's how the rest of the world views us, and they also made the point very fairly that Scotland, grim as that situation, is over-endowed with talent and artists that can enhance Scotland's reputation. So that would be my main appeal, that the place-based approach which we're talking about today, supporting it, is also done at the same time as we support culture and try and reverse the damage of Brexit that we have seen decimating our cultural sector.
Thank you, Ms Brown. I now call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Cocab Stewart. Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate today on the conclusions and recommendations contained in the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee's report titled Culture and Communities, the Challenges and Opportunities in Delivering a Place-Based Approach. I commend the members of the committee and the clerks for their work and all those who contributed. Today I will highlight two areas in particular that the committee report examined, which I believe need greater focus from the government. My speech will discuss funding challenges for the cultural sector, and then I will move on to the need for the government and its agencies to listen to local communities and empower them. Firstly, the committee looked in detail at funding issues in the cultural sector. They heard from a National Museum of Scotland spokesperson that the current financial climate is one of the toughest the heritage and culture sector has ever faced. The Federation of Scottish Theatre said that organisations that deliver cultural work in communities are in an extremely precarious financial position. The committee report cited a SPICE assessment which found that the total grant funding for Creative Scotland in 2021-22 was about 10% lower in real terms than in 2014-15. The lack of funding from the SNP government has been a real thorn in the side of the cultural sector. But the problem is not only the lack of funding, but the inconsistency of its delivery. Even when they're announcing more funding for culture, the SNP have often managed to make a confusing mess of it. Last year, they cut the budget for Creative Scotland by several million pounds. Then they made a big announcement that actually they were restoring the funding. After patting themselves on the back, the SNP then announced that actually they'd changed their mind and that they were going to go ahead with cutting that funding. This flip-flopping doesn't help the culture sector to plan. How are the organisations supposed to plan when the SNP U-turn on a U-turn on a U-turn? No, the time's short today. The lack of certainty and stability makes their life very difficult. That's just one example, but the committee report looked at many other funding issues. In particular, the extremely short-term approach of culture policy came in for substantial criticism. Professor David Stevenson, Dean of the School of Arts, Social Sciences and Management at Queen Margaret University, said, in his words, "The biggest challenge the culture sector faces is a persistent and pernicious obsession with short-term project funding." Scottish Ballet said that this approach created a stop-start mechanism. The Federation of Scottish Theatre also highlighted issues with the inconsistency of funding. Professor Stevenson said that in other countries there is, and I quote, "much clearer understanding of how different elements of the funding landscape support different things." I hope the government reflects on that and learns from the best examples of how other countries operate. I note that earlier this year, the Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson said he was keen to work in a multi-year funding approach, and I hope that that work will conclude imminently. A clearer funding system would be very beneficial to the culture sector. However, funding is not the only issue that needs addressed to promote culture more effectively in Scotland. The government must also listen more closely to communities. As a point of principle, my party believes that local people are best placed to decide what's best for their community. We firmly support communities having more power to shape the cultural life in their own local area. The best preservers and promoters of local heritage and cultural sites are the people in those areas. They must be empowered to take the lead themselves, free from the constraints of too much bureaucracy or too much imposition and top-down control from the government. The role of the government and councils must be to deliver the platform and the environment so that local communities feel able to make a difference themselves. As it stands, the government are not meeting their end of the bargain. Returning to Professor Stevenson's evidence to the committee, he noted that, and I quote, "we fall into thinking that there is a one-size-fits-all model." The report also notes his comments around the danger of only helping individuals overcome barriers to cultural participation, where these are barriers to the type of culture that we feel is valuable for them to take part in. It was welcome in their evidence to the committee that Creative Scotland acknowledged that there are cases of what might be felt as, "we are doing good to communities, we are offering you something, so come and see it," without understanding what it can mean to the people and what the unmet need is in that community. All of this evidence seems to indicate that at the moment there is too much of a top-down approach to culture in Scotland. Local communities are often boxed into what cultural projects they get, and that's not how it should be. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I hope to see the government focus on improving how they cooperate and work with local communities, and I hope they will address the inconsistency of funding so the culture sector can more effectively plan for the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dowie. I now call Co-Cab Stewart, to be followed by Colin Smith. Ms Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I would like to start by praising the work of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. A lot of work goes into taking evidence and producing these reports, and the result here is something that's informative and I hope can guide the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government's commitment to a place-based approach within our cultural strategy stands as a testament to the belief in empowering communities and fostering their engagement and weaving their stories into the very fabric of our national identity. And what's clear to me as a representative of this place, of many communities from Glasgow Kelvin as well, is that the affiliation people have to the place they belong is so important. It's about identity of belonging, and it's the overall welfare of communities and the people who live in them. So this is a strategy that not only recognises the intrinsic value of cultural diversity, but it seeks to empower diverse local voices in weaving that cultural tartan of our nation. However, in navigating this, there must be a great many challenges which we must be cognisant of and work together to resolve. The economic landscape that we face today is littered with financial constraints, as was mentioned by Keith Brown, my colleague. These present formidable barriers in financing community-based cultural initiatives, nurturing local government cultural services, and providing the essential spaces where cultural expression can flourish. Now, these challenges, although significant, present opportunities for strategic intervention and innovative solutions, aligning our endeavours with our collective aspirations. And from my perspective, as the member for Glasgow Kelvin, the culture strategy emphasis on community and place is pivotal. Many members will already be aware of the community victory over Children's Wood in my constituency, which is a fantastic outdoor community space where actually I held my first ever surgery after being elected. Over a relentless 25-year campaign, teachers, climate advocates, local residents, and even celebrities, one of whom was indeed our late Queen, rallied to protect the Children's Wood and North Kelvin Meadow. In 2020, a grant of a community asset transfer by Glasgow City Council signified more than just land preservation. It symbolises the triumph of collective will and the validation of a community vision. And this success isn't solely about land, it's about nurturing a community heartbeat. The Children's Wood Chair, Professor Niamh Stack, rightfully calls it a community anchor, emphasising its pivotal role in current times. And I frequently visit there and join in with a wide variety of the activities that take place, including hearing children and families running around in their laughter, hearing the buzz of the bees from the hives that are kept there, and also listening to opportunities where toddlers and mums can get together to not only weave stories in the local environment, but also develop, amongst other things, Scottish storytelling. The agreement demonstrates a shared commitment to empowering communities, and this is a model for fostering sustainable, playful and resilient communities, especially vital after the challenges that are faced. Yet there remains an inherent need for a deeper integration of community culture in what we do. And the Scottish Government's commitment to empowerment mechanisms, such as the Place Principle, calls for a robust amplification of cultural voices at the grassroots level. The committee's inquiry into this matter unveils the positive strides made in place-based cultural initiatives across the communities. There is a resounding recognition from a diverse array of stakeholders regarding the importance of this approach. This recognition is deeply rooted in the Scottish Government's cultural strategy, which, building on long-standing ambitions, seeks to adopt place-based and community-led approaches to service delivery. However, the findings from this inquiry also highlight the substantial hurdles that must be addressed to realise the aspirations set forth in the strategy. These challenges, spanning both national and local spheres, require a whole system approach. And overcoming these hurdles, cohesive collaboration across the different layers of government, transcending partisan interests for the collective betterment of our cultural landscape. And to be completely frank, more than a decade of austerity, polished off by economic turmoil at the hands of the Tory UK government, has presented severe challenges to the implementation of place-based cultural policy. These constraints affect the funding of the community-based cultural organisations and support for local government cultural services and the provision of publicly owned community spaces that are vital for cultural activities. Despite the commendable emphasis on the role of communities and place within the culture strategy, there remains a pressing need for a more robust prioritisation of community culture, putting it at the core of the sector. This report is a call to action to the Scottish Government to address these challenges and heed the findings and recommendations. The imminent finalisation of the refreshed Culture Strategy Action Plan later this year presents a critical juncture to tackle these essential facets that will ultimately shape Scotland's cultural trajectory. And I commend the report. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Stewart. I now call Colin Smith to be followed by Emma Harper. Mr Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I add my thanks to the members of the committee for carrying out this inquiry, those who gave evidence and the committee's clerks and researchers for their work distilling that evidence into the committee's report, an excellent report which makes a timely and important contribution to the debate on the crucial role of the culture sector in our local communities. I was particularly pleased the committee took time to visit my hometown of Dumfries, where they experienced an outstanding example of that place-based approach by the Stove Network that has been genuinely shaped by the community. I've had the privilege of working with the Stove since its inception over a decade ago, including as local councillor when the council transferred the High Street base to the Stove in a community asset transfer. I've seen it firsthand, the development of that property into a cafe, a meeting place, an outstanding events venue. But it's what the people inside do that excites me, the way the Stove have used arts and cultural activities to bring together diverse communities to drive positive place-based solutions to the challenges people care about, for example, the future of their town centre. Using arts and culture not as an end in itself, but as a means to deliver a well-being economy. The Stove's engagement with people, often underrepresented groups in some of the most vulnerable communities, on issues relevant to their lives, ensure those solutions are genuinely bottom-up, not top-down, an important principle stressed by Dumfries and Galloway Council in their submission to the committee. It was that work by the Stove that led to the creation of the Mid-Steeple Quarter in Dumfries, a community benefit company taking on the problem of absent landlords in our town centres, becoming the landlord themselves, taking back our high street shop by shop, investing in neglected properties and then using them for the benefit of the community. But the work of the Stove goes beyond Dumfries town centre, and I know the committee also visited Lochside, a community I'm proud to say I was brought up in, where members witnessed the DG Lift project, which again is supporting and transforming the community. That project is again community driven, using culture, the arts, to build community confidence, to take on and dispel the outdated negative perception of the area, and in doing so seek to change the perception that culture's not for me. But the committee heard that one of the biggest barriers the Stove and others faced with these projects was the outdated approach we have to how we fund culture and the arts, an approach that means it's about performance, often professional, not participation, and certainly not community participation. That means when seeking support for their important cultural contribution to building that wellbeing economy, the Stove often finds itself competing with wellbeing projects such as food banks for non-culture-based sources of funding, because the current silo model of Creative Scotland funding doesn't properly recognise cultural and community participation. On the committee's visit to Dumfries, members heard about a different approach in Ireland, where there are separate bodies and separate funding streams for participation and community-based practice. But we don't have to look beyond Scotland to see that. Sport Scotland recognised the role sport has on our wellbeing, particularly health, with separate funding streams for elite sport and for participation in sport. As the Stove said in their submission to the committee, in culture, we do not have the participation strand, only the elite one. Presiding Officer, the Government have said they now intend to double culture spending, which I welcome, but I hope as they grow that budget, it cannot just be about more of the same. We need to better recognise the wider role of culture in delivering that wellbeing economy, its preventative social impact on social isolation, on mental health, by better ring-fencing funding streams for community participation. I also hope the Government will look again at the geographical spread of funding. The focus on professional performance does often mean a disproportionate amount goes towards big events in our cities, and that often leaves events in peripheral communities where margins are tighter in a precarious position. Festivals and events are hugely important to my home region of Dumfries and Galloway. However, in recent years we have lost major festivals. The Wicker Man Festival, the Electric Fields Festival, now the Big Burn Supper Festival has been cancelled for this year. The Eden Festival has also scaled back, given the challenges of higher policing costs since the establishment of Police Scotland. Yet when new developing events such as Music at the Multiverse emerge in a bid to replace those we've lost, they haven't received the support needed from Events Scotland and other national agencies to develop. In the 3 years since Music at the Multiverse began, studies have shown the important economic benefit it has on Upper Nithsdale, one of the most deprived parts of Scotland, and there's clearly a real potential to grow that contribution to make the visitor attraction of the Croyt Multiverse viable for the future. But that hasn't been recognised when it comes to support. Likewise, as a result of the Scottish Government's decision to remove Winter Festival funding in 2022 and then the rejection again by Events Scotland of an application from Dumfries and Galloway. Sadly, the curtain has been pulled on the Big Burns Supper this year, a genuine grassroots event that has transformed the lives of hundreds of young people who trained as the producers of the future. Ministers used to queue up to cut the ribbon at the opening of the Big Burns Supper. Sadly now, the only cut being made by the government is in the funding to the main event celebrating the birthday of Scotland's greatest cultural icon, all for the sake of £25,000. Presiding officer, it's a huge blow to the south of Scotland, and it does show that we still have a long way to go to properly recognise the value of grassroots community participation events and to ensure that every part of Scotland is fairly supported in delivering them. That's why I very much welcome and thank the committee for this important contribution to the debate on tackling this issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Smith. And I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate, and I too put my thanks on the record to the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee, the members and the clerks for creating this comprehensive report on culture and communities. And places and people underpin culture and communities across Scotland and generate a distinct sense of place, identity and confidence. And Keith Brown's absolutely right to mention that supporting culture isn't just about economics. There is so much value that people obtain in cultural experiences. And evidence from this report consistently points to the need for integrated, coordinated actions to deliver improvements for communities rather than a focus which isolates social, economic or physical aspects. The Scottish Government's Culture Strategy Action Plan Refresh will support the recovery and renewal of the culture sector with a focus on empowering individuals and communities to further develop their own cultural activity. And I welcome that the Scottish Government have provided this commitment following the committee report. Presiding Officer, Scotland is a place where culture is valued, protected and nurtured. Culture is woven through everyday life, shapes and is shaped by society, and its transformative potential is experienced by everyone. Scotland's rich cultural heritage and creativity of today is inspired by people and place. It enlivens every community and is celebrated around the world. However, as the community report acknowledges, we do have challenges within the cultural sector. I'm all too aware of these challenges from my own constituency casework in Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish Borders, and it is important to acknowledge that the Scottish Government is operating in an extremely challenging fiscal context. And a combination of the impacts of Brexit, the aftermath of the pandemic and the energy crisis fuelled by Russia's illegal invasion of Ukraine have sent prices spiralling upwards. In light of this challenging context, the Scottish Government has been reviewing the actions that support its culture strategy. And although the aims and ambitions of the culture strategy are still relevant, the Scottish Government will publish a refreshed action plan later this year, setting out what it will do to respond to those challenges. That plan will include actions on how the Scottish Government will support culture and creativity in our communities. It will support them to do so by identifying and removing barriers to access, championing the economic impact of culture as well. While this is welcome, it is important to acknowledge the impact of the removal of much of the Winter Festival funding, which has impacted the grassroots created Big Burn Supper, and Colin Smith has just outlined the challenges there as well. They have had to cancel their 2024 festival. But I've been working closely with the team at the Big Burn Supper, and it's now in its 13th year, so I've been working with them to support them, and I thank the Minister for her engagement and advice to me so far. I'm planning to convene a round table with the Big Burn Supper, Event Scotland, Creative Scotland and additional key players to discuss how the Big Burn Supper could be supported in the future, and even similar organisations, how they can be supported better in the future. This will include how organisations like Event Scotland could potentially improve their communication should funding and other issues arise. I ask if the Minister would agree that this is important for key persons from these bodies to engage in such roundtable discussions so as to support our creative and event sector and to look to improve the support offered to them. Presiding Officer, I would also like to highlight some of the key points from the committee evidence session which took place in Dumfries. and I was pleased to be able to join the committee members that day, Neil Bibby, Donald Cameron and Ben McPherson, when he was on the committee at the time. There was 3 site meetings and we met representatives from the Stove Network, Athy Erts and Sankar, and representatives from D&G Council and Lift D&G. And again, Colin Smith has described well what the Stove and Lift do in our communities, and I enjoy engaging with them and supporting them and working with the Stove Network and Lift as well. The committee heard that good place-based cultural policy involves empowering the local community to create a cultural offering that caters to their specific needs. Dumfries and Galloway Council provided evidence that to overcome barriers to cultural participation, it is important to support communities to grow the cultural activities that they want to see, rather than taking a top-down approach. Rural transport was flagged by all as a huge issue for people in the area and a barrier to cultural participation. And since the pandemic, there has been more awareness of the need for a hybrid approach, recognising the need for direct human connection, but also in keeping engaged for those people who might not be able to travel to events in person. We saw during the pandemic, during the lockdown, that Big Burn Supper, they broadcast online and they reached 300,000 people globally. So this was pretty excellent that they took to the online platform during the pandemic. So we can learn from what we had to do while we were required to stay at home. The work and the support of the South Scotland Enterprise Agency was discussed in positive terms, with the agency adopting a strategic overview and encouraging what was seen as a shift in the approach to community engagement and finding support for individual projects. Finally, Presiding Officer, Stranraer Oyster Festival was cited as an example of where that engagement worked really well. That's a grassroots organised festival as well, and it's held over 2.5 days and has contributed £2.3 million to the local economy this year alone. So that is a complete local culture success, and I know that the Rural Cabinet Secretary will attest to that. So finally, Presiding Officer, there are important recommendations.
Ms Harper, we don't have any time in hand. Could you please bring your
remarks? Okay, yep, I am in my final sentence, so I welcome the committee's report and this debate today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I now call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Audrey Nicholl. Mr Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It has been an absolute privilege to sit on the committee during this inquiry. We had a really unique opportunity to hear from an incredible array of cultural organisations and artists from across Scotland, ranging from grassroots community arts groups to more established national charities and projects. But it has at times been a pretty humbling experience because, you know, while we've spoken quite often about there being a perfect storm facing our cultural sector, it's another thing to actually hear firsthand just the scale of the challenge that many of these organisations are facing. So I would really like to take this opportunity to thank all of those who gave evidence in this inquiry. And of course, culture doesn't happen exclusively in the programmes of national performing companies or gallery spaces, hugely important as they are. Culture is also in the very fabric of our communities and civic spaces. It's in every community-led arts group up and down the country, and in hubs which bring creative projects together, like Creative Stirling or Whale Arts. And it's the work of these organisations that's vital to our national cultural ecology, and they're everywhere that you look. These cultural spaces are where communities can come together to educate and to organise. And of course, during the depths of the COVID crisis, it was often these organisations who helped look after each other. Now, the evidence from Edinburgh's cultural hubs in this inquiry was important. It underlined that even in a city where we have a big and profitable culture sector, communities can easily be left behind unless there's a commitment to partnership and to co-production. The community hubs want to be empowered to do amazing things rather than just to get free tickets for fringe shows. And it's often the makers, artists and other creatives who are providing that spark for transformation and change while providing support for the most vulnerable. So Radical Weavers in Stirling, for example, are helping survivors of trauma through weaving, including ex-servicemen. But they've also run a project to help trans and non-binary folk alter clothing, building personal confidence and connection to a wider community. And this lunchtime, we heard from other wonderful community organisations who are working on rehabilitation and empowerment of vulnerable people. This inquiry took the time to explore culture in communities in all its forms and in all its spaces. And the consensus was clear that the vision for place-based culture is clear, but it is a fragile ecology which needs to be protected and nurtured if it is to thrive. The funding settlement given to the Scottish Government from Westminster does not keep pace with inflation and is forcing difficult choices. And when projects and organisations are already running on shoestring budgets, changes to funding can have a disproportionate impact on delivery. Standstill funding across the sector has meant that many groups are trying to do more with less. Running costs for organisations are skyrocketing, while the need for affordable cultural activities continues to grow. Project-based funding has hollowed out community organisations' finances, with many struggling to cover core costs or keep buildings running. And local authority arts and cultural services have, of course, been cut to the bone. So the committee's report is clear. We must find a way forward that provides the financial security and certainty that our cultural sector needs. And we must do that with some urgency. So I'm pleased that the First Minister has made the commitment to double cultural funding over the next 5 years, with increases starting from next year's budget. But beyond bigger budget lines, we need to rethink the way the sector is funded to secure a sustainable future. There are innovative financial levers we can use, and some of them are already under development. We need to see a long-term strategy for culture that pivots away from stop-start funding towards multi-year budgets. Now, the new Creative Scotland funding model will go some way towards this, allowing cultural organisations to do long-term community development work to thrive, not just to survive. But we also agreed that community-based organisations support the fulfilment of many of our key national outcomes across government, and our funding model should also reflect this. So this is about understanding the wider benefits that culture brings, including through leveraging spending across government portfolios for culture. We know that the Scottish Government is still in the early days of considering cross-departmental budgeting for culture and preventative spend, but we can't sustain our culture ecology from a single budget line. This work really has to be accelerated. And there are important lessons from Wales here too, where the Future Generations Commissioner has embedded that longer-term thinking about culture, place and the role of preventative spend into the public sector. Now, the report calls for innovation in cultural funding, such as a percentage for the arts scheme. And we also looked at the potential use of the transient visitor levy and the importance of having a cultural voice at the table when councils are looking at how that's spent. But we can see how percentage for the arts schemes have worked across the world, in Netherlands, Ireland and the States, redirecting funds from major developments into the arts. And it's time that we developed more tools like this in Scotland under devolved powers. Although I do agree with Keith Brown, because you know, Ireland has turned into a cultural powerhouse because it is an independent country. It has the powers of a small independent nation, and it has not severed its ties with the EU. It is integrated into the EU, and that has driven its incredible work on culture. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Cultural Strategy Action Plan later this year will be a really important opportunity for the Scottish Government to set out a plan that delivers radical change for our community cultural sector. And I hope to see the committee's recommendations reflected in the action plan. And I'm excited to see what the new investment in the sector can deliver over the next 5 years.
Thank you, Mr. Ruscoe. And I now call Audrey Nicol, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Ms. Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a substitute member of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee, I'm very pleased to speak in this debate this afternoon, one that has offered us the opportunity to celebrate an amazing wealth of culture in our communities, but while thinking about how we respond to the many challenges already outlined facing culture, building on the opportunities that already exist and enabling local communities to shape what that looks like and make it sustainable in the longer term. The fiscal landscape is indeed very challenging, however, and in this regard, I'm very pleased that Scottish Government is refreshing the National Culture Strategy Action Plan, taking account of the way in which external factors like the COVID-19 pandemic, rising energy prices, and Brexit have had on our cultural sector. And I recall only too well meeting local creators in my constituency last year and hearing their deep concerns about whether or not they would be able to keep their studios open due to the sharp rise in energy prices and rental costs. So these challenges are very real and there is work for us to do. The report produced by the committee is extremely comprehensive. It recognises that a place-based approach to culture is not new, and it considers a number of challenges in delivering local culture, including supporting cultural activity through, for example, volunteering, cultural provision, and protecting spaces for culture. And personally, I found it an immensely helpful report in providing a reference point for what I and others should be thinking about in terms of how we support culture in our communities and regions. The report reflects the importance of local networks to cultural ecology. Dmouth Artist Studios in my constituency is a perfect example, home to artists, designers and makers with a strong relationship with Gray's School of Art and community and cultural organisations. But there is absolutely no doubt that the success of the studios has been a slow burn, it has been hard earned, and it has faced many challenges, not least of all funding, as highlighted in the report. I welcome the Scottish Government's recent announcement of almost £7 million to support the culture sector and, of course, the £100 million committed by the Scottish Government to the sector over the next 5 years, reflecting the real value we place on culture in our communities at a time when the fiscal landscape has never been so challenging. And I would seek an assurance that the culture funding through, for example, the Culture Collective programme, continues to support grassroots projects so that place-based culture like the Torrey Heritage Trust, the Doric Festival and the North East Open Studios in my constituency can be sustained in the longer term. Another issue highlighted in the report is that of community assets, and I highlight the ongoing effort made in my constituency to secure the community asset transfer of a former police station that has recently closed to become a community hub that will support culture. And I recognise that there is already a community asset transfer process available for this purpose. However, I am concerned, and I think I reflect at the concerns of those involved in this particular transfer opportunity, that the process is less than user-friendly for groups that are perhaps unfamiliar with what is required. And I think this was a point raised previously by Alexander Stewart. And I hope the Scottish Government responds to the committee's recommendation to engage with organisations to better understand what support can be provided around community ownership of assets, enabling them to really realise their cultural potential in a truly place-based way. And I also want to pay tribute this afternoon to the volunteers and others supporting culture in the justice space. I recently hosted Aid and Abet in the Scottish Parliament, an organisation that supports recovery for people leaving prison, and we celebrated the recent launch of The Good Prison Officer, a collection of reflections written by ex-prisoners about their experience of prison, and a really fantastic example of how imprisonment inadvertently led to a creative endeavour in bringing a group of people together to write about their life-changing relationships with prison officers. And I pay tribute to Space Art Scotland, Kessler Arts, and the many projects and organisations that promote access to the creative arts for those subject to and in the justice system. Through exhibitions and creative interventions, they harness the arts to support rehabilitation and recovery from alcohol and drug harm. Some may feel culture injustice is a bit of a stretch in the context of place-based culture. I disagree. And you only had to pop along to the Culture and Communities event in the Parliament earlier on this afternoon to hear the fantastic North Lanarkshire Recovery Band supported by Real Time to appreciate just the utter value of this important work. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, my thanks again to the committee for bringing this debate forward, reflecting the content of a really important report. And I look forward to remaining involved and working for my constituents in this wonderful creative space. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicol. And we now move to closing speeches. I call on Faisal Chowdhury to close on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, place-based approaches to culture are vital. They allow for communities to make decisions about culture that best suit the needs and wants of the local population and allow for much-needed local engagement in Scotland's culture. I welcome the announcement of an extra £100 million for the arts and culture budget and await further details. However, this report and the committee's pre-budget scrutiny highlights the questions still need to be answered given the dire situation facing our cultural sector. As Karen Adam and Kit Brown rightly pointed out, we are in the difficult financial situation and the cultural sector is feeling the brunt of this. I have been contacted by a number of organisations and event organisers whose future remains uncertain due to the continued funding cuts in the arts. As a result, Scotland's cultural sector hangs in the balance. A straightforward and coherent approach to protect Scotland's unique culture and heritage is crucial. Cuts and short-term projects-based funding schemes jeopardise the ability of cultural programmes to reflect the communities they serve. Our culture sector needs long-term, sustained funding. Community organisations cannot continue operating, wondering when the next funding cuts will be. Long-term and continued funding is the only way that a place-based approach to culture in the communities can work. Without it, community organisations cannot plan ahead. They cannot commit to cultural event and they cannot ensure progress for culture in their own communities. A successful place-based approach to culture must also address the individual needs of people in each community. The report rightly recognises the important role that volunteers play in supporting community-led cultural activities. However, Neil Beebe rightly pointed out the need to address the disparity between communities who do not have the capacity or resources to sustain a long-term volunteering. The cultural needs of one community may not be the same for the other. Scotland is a diverse place. There must be a targeted approach to ensure that each community's unique needs are being met. A place-based approach must also acknowledge the unique cultural heritage and history of individual communities. It must recognise the multicultural heritage and make-up of many communities across Scotland and work towards meeting the needs of the many, not the few. Presiding Officer, a place-based approach to culture is what is best to serve our communities. But this cannot be fully implemented without decision-making being handed back to the local communities. Decentralisation would put decision-making closer home and back to the hands of those that it directly impacts. Local communities know best their own cultural needs. By giving communities a choice and say in shaping the cultural life of their communities, we will only help to strengthen and improve multiculturalism and Scotland's rich cultural heritage. Finally, Presiding Officer, despite Scottish Government commitments to culture, access to cultural spaces in communities is on the decline. Giving power to the communities to implement for their own cultural activities will go nowhere if local spaces are not made available to bring them to light. Alexander Stewart rightly pointed out that there is immense pressure on many communities, arts groups to rescue spaces used for community cultural activities. There are some success stories with this, such as North Edinburgh Arts in my region. But the current crisis facing the sector means that many community organisation spaces are still at threat of closure. This is particularly in deprived urban areas where individuals may feel further removed from engaging in culture. We must ensure spaces are open and maintained to allow communities to meet the cultural needs of individuals and encourage everyone to engage in local cultural and arts settings. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. And I now call on Pam Gozo to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms. Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to contribute to today's debate on how we can empower our communities to deliver a place-based approach. And it's great to hear today around the Chamber that if there's one thing that we all agree on is how important and how valuable our cultural sector is. Scotland is a country that is rich in cultural heritage. It is therefore not surprising that in every corner of the country we see communities approaching cultural projects in their own unique way. I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the amazing work done with the great organisations and volunteers in my own region. This includes the Milgai BID, who do a great work in bringing the local community together with events such as Milgai Street Party, and the Mary Milgai, and many others. I welcome that the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs and Culture Committee has been able to produce their report, which sets out a way forward for a place-based approach to culture. I would also like to thank everybody that came along to the committee to provide evidence to the committee. I hope that the Scottish Government will pay close attention to this report's recommendations. The report speaks about the key role played by local support networks within our communities. And it's important that we recognise the importance of the cultural ecosystem within the communities. Local networks of community-based organisations are vital to the ecosystem. We should not forget that these networks are often made up almost entirely of volunteers whose time and efforts is essential to the delivery of cultural projects. Volunteer Scotland highlights that so much of the work done by volunteers is unseen, but that it is essential to community projects. But we need to recognise that not all communities have equal access to these local networks of support. The committee's work revealed that communities in more deprived areas simply have less time to volunteer. In 2021, the Scottish Household Survey revealed that just 21% of people in the most deprived areas were involved in volunteering in the previous 12 months, compared to 33% for the least deprived areas. But a community with fewer potential volunteers does not mean a community with less cultural needs. Cultural events can provide an important boost to people's mental health and can allow people to escape their everyday lives. This is just as true in one area as it is in the next. We also know that many of these volunteer-led groups face significant financial challenges. Many of these groups are almost entirely self-funded, and more of them are having to charge for their services. At the very least, this makes cultural activities even less accessible to communities with more deprivation. But at the worst, it makes many cultural projects unsustainable. The committee is therefore right to urge both the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland to explore further avenues of support to protect and enhance these fantastic volunteer-led projects in our communities. On this note, it is of course difficult to talk about support for cultural activities without discussing the issue of funding. As has been mentioned already this afternoon, today is not the time to rerun debates on local authority funding trends, but the fact is that local government funding has fallen in real terms over the last decade. It is therefore unsurprising that an analysis by the Audit Scotland shows the local government spending on culture leisure services has fallen nearly 20% since 2013. I don't think I have enough time on this. The committee was therefore right to recommend that the government works with Creative Scotland, COSLA and individual councils to assess the impact of the current physical environment on local cultural projects. I hope that the Minister, when closing, will be able to comment further on this recommendation and how the government plans to address this decline. But another barrier preventing community groups from engaging in cultural projects is about the red tape that these groups are facing, which is another issue that the committee was right to highlight. I hope that the government is able to engage with Planning Aid Scotland to ensure that unnecessary bureaucracy does not prevent communities from pursuing cultural projects. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, there are numerous challenges facing Scotland's cultural landscape. While various public bodies have a role to play tackling these issues, the Scottish Government must play its own part. I hope that the Government listens to what the cultural sector and the committee's report is telling them. We need to see clear assurances that the current decline in cultural spend will be reversed and a clear strategy for how our communities will be empowered to take forward the cultural projects they choose. With these steps, I hope that Scotland's vibrant cultural landscape will be able to truly live up to its full potential.
Thank you. And I call on Christina McKelvey to wind up. Up to 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I would first like to thank my colleagues for their contributions today and the committee, diligently chaired by Claire Adamson, for its detailed report. I am very pleased that we have the opportunity this afternoon to discuss the importance of culture in our communities. And today, Claire Adamson hosted groups who had given evidence in our Parliament, the North Lanarkshire Recovery Group and Real Time Music, who created the band, who sang their own songs and gave us all a very poignant rendition of Stand By Me. And I think that's a nice note to take away for today. I have been listening with interest, Presiding Officer, to all the contributions across the Chamber today on the challenges and the opportunities in delivering a place-based approach. As Creative Scotland has said, a good place-based cultural policy recognises individual needs of people, communities and places, recognises the unique culture and heritage of individuals and communities, and responds to the ambition, need and challenges of each place. Presiding Officer, we are a nation of storytellers, and at that event Claire Adamson chaired today, I loved hearing a spellbinding tale from Jane Mathers from her very own storytelling centre in Edinburgh, a salient tale about heeding the advice from your mammy and your granny. This aligns well with our ambitions of culture, the culture strategy, and we remain fully committed to delivering at this standard for everyone in Scotland. And can I pick up the points raised by both Emma Harper and Colin Smith on the Big Burn Supper? I have been in communication with the organisers of the Big Burn Supper, and Creative Scotland continues to have a relationship with Electric Theatre Workshop, who manage the Big Burn Supper, and Creative Scotland are also engaging with them to advise on any suitable funding routes. And can I thank Emma Harper? I'm grateful to her for the work that she is doing to support the Big Burn Supper. And yes, I do agree on the importance of the round table and the event, and I will look forward to the response from that. We have embodied this commitment through our support of programmes like Culture Collective. We've heard a lot about that today. For example, the Eyre Gaiety Culture Collective worked with partners including the Violence Reduction Unit, Newton Primary School, South Ayrshire Council and others to gather ideas about what the community needed and wanted. And that came across very clear today from the people from the Recovery Network and the band at Claire Adamson's event. That was really important to them. One member told me the importance of the music was life-saving, and I don't think we can underplay how powerful that is. This work that we have done so far and the work of the culture collectives and others have led to the development of community gardens, women's groups, a range of summer activities for young people. It is one of the many opportunities the programme created, but also demonstrates where Scottish Government support is fostering grassroots community-developed initiatives. However, our support for culture and communities reaches far beyond our funded programmes, and I'm sure everyone in here would welcome the extra £100 million announced by our First Minister. Along with COSLA, the COSLA spokesperson for Community Wellbeing, Councillor Maureen Chalmers, and I co-chair the Culture Conveners Group. This group of elected officials shares the Scottish Government's view that culture is of great importance to our communities across the country, and we are working with them to develop ways for local and national organisations to work together to further our shared priorities. We heard many examples today of these contributions, and I hope colleagues welcome this local and national government collaboration. We are exploring and discussing the provision of cultural services, the impact of the cost crisis, the impact of Brexit, as well as an accessible recovery. I raised all of these issues with Lord Whittingdale a few weeks ago, and Tories in this place really cannot just blame the Scottish Government when most of the challenges that these organisations face and the response to them lie with the UK Government. We can't get away from that fact. And to fully harness this potential, it's been clear that we need to collaborate strategically across central and local government, using all of the lessons, creativity, levers and comparative advantage that we can bring to the table. Mark Ruskell and Colin Smith described Ireland and how it funds their cultural organisation. Well, that's the power of a small independent nation with a budget surplus. Our cultural strategy sets our ambition that everyone should be able to experience the empowering potential of culture wherever they live in Scotland. And Mark Ruskell reminded us that cultural groups brought us all light in the dark days of COVID. Presiding Officer, Alexander Stewart, Neil Bibby, Keith Brown, Colin Smythe, Audrey Nicholl all spoke of community ownership, and we know that ownership and control of land and buildings is a powerful tool for communities to drive change and achieve their own goals. It can help to develop the local economy, provide activities and services, and boost community identity. And Audrey Nicholl mentioned the challenges with the process. I hope she will be interested to know that the Scottish Government launched a review of the Community Empowerment Act on the 21st of July 2022, and work to review the Act is due to conclude in early 2024, with the report being made available. And I hope members take an active interest in that. Place-based and community-based collaborations can be the very heartbeat of our local community. We heard that today. Presiding Officer, we also heard about cultural assets and the cultural programme, so let's look at that. Keith Brown spoke of funding constraints, and others did as well. The outlook for our capital budget is very challenging, with high inflation and a projected 6.7% real terms reduction in our capital funding over the medium term. To meet all the pressures and spending commitments within the investment pipeline, an additional £1.9 million for 24-25, £2.5 billion for 25-26 and £2.8 billion for 26-27 is required against a funding envelope of £5.9 billion. The numbers speak for themselves. Presiding Officer, I heard Faisal Chowdhury. I also always enjoy listening to Faisal Chowdhury, and he brings up the terms of how diverse and multicultural our nation is and the importance of including that. Pam Gosel raised that in her point as well. And as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, our refreshed cultural strategy action plan, developed with close engagement with the sector, will set out actions we will take forward to respond to some of the challenges we've heard today, including around a place-based approach to culture. And I will ensure that Faisal Chowdhury's ask is considered in amongst this. And you've heard from the Cabinet Secretary today when he talked about the new funding that we have mentioned this week, £6.68 million. I know that was welcomed by many, including Audrey Nicholl, and I know that Keith Brown will be interested to know that the impact of Brexit has been taken into account here, because we have now committed that additional funding to our National Performance Companies Touring Fund. Presiding Officer, I think there is agreement across the Chamber on the importance of culture in our communities and a recognition that we must collaborate to realise the full potential of place-based culture. Alexander Stewart asked the Scottish Government to approach the recommendations of the report in good faith. I can certainly agree to do exactly that. And we can all acknowledge culture's unique power to inspire, enrich and transform lives, not only as individuals, but also for the collective well-being of our communities. Presiding Officer, CoCab Stewart said, "We are a richer nation for our weaving of our cultural tartan," and I couldn't agree more, and I think this debate demonstrates that.
Thank you. And I call on Donald Cameron to wind up the debate on behalf of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This has been a wide-ranging and helpful debate. Can I take this opportunity to add my thanks to the committee clerks for all their work on this inquiry into culture in the communities, and to all those who gave evidence to the committee, to those who hosted visits from the committee, including the excellent visits that some of us took part in to the Stove Network and Lift D&G in Dumfries, to the various venues here in Edinburgh, as well as a visit to Orkney that some members of the committee attended. Before I respond to the contributions that have been made, can I expand on some other important aspects of our report, further to those raised by the convener in her opening speech? Through our inquiry, we sought to better understand the factors which either support or impede the development and growth of cultural activity within communities in Scotland. And one thing that we consistently heard was that there must be physical spaces in which cultural activities can take place. That can include traditional venues, such as theatres and cinemas, but also it can include community assets, such as village halls, community centres, schools, libraries, church buildings, which are equally important to the cultural ecology. On our visit to Dumfries, we saw the vital role of the Stove Network building, which provides a cultural venue and meeting place on the High Street in Dumfries and is somewhere to bring the community together to participate in culture. And in Lochside, we visited the Lift D&G project space, which was now operating as a community hub, having successfully moved into community ownership. But we've also been concerned to hear of a growing trend of cultural and community assets becoming less available, less affordable, and at risk of closure. And that will no doubt negatively impact on access to culture for those communities. Volunteer Scotland lamented the lack of affordable and accessible community venues. Fashion and Gale said unaffordable rental levels for community spaces such as school buildings present a very real threat to community cultural activities. Making Music said the rationalisation of the church estate was proving a significant challenge for its members. And Creative Lives expressed concerns about the longer-term viability of venues run by local councils or arm's-length culture trusts, which may be subject to closure as they face financial pressure. Professor David Stevenson spoke of the anguish expressed over the closure of the Film House, but said that the closure of community halls, the cornerstone of community culture, was being ignored. He told us that the impact of community spaces closing was, and I quote, "even more significant in rural areas and smaller places in terms of the effect of one space, one community hall, that had supported a multitude of cultural activities closing down." We heard that there was a need to improve the mapping of assets at a local level in order to support those assets to be better used, to improve understanding of the impact that individual site closures could have within the wider local context, and to inform planning decisions. We heard that the Scottish Government should also have a better understanding of which communities across Scotland have limited access to spaces for culture. We considered community ownership as one possible route to keeping spaces open for use by the community. And in her opening remarks, the convener touched upon the vital role of volunteers in sustaining community culture, but also the burden this can place on individuals. And we heard similar challenges in relation to community ownership of assets. That requires expertise, as well as the time and resources of volunteers, and there are often high costs associated with the management and maintenance of these spaces. It was clear to us that community ownership, therefore, cannot always be the answer to protecting cultural assets subject to closure. But where this is a viable option, communities need to be provided with ongoing support and advice. Yes, of course. Neil Bibby.
We also heard during the evidence the importance of transport links and affordable and reliable public transport to get people to those spaces and access cultural opportunities. Would you agree with me it's another issue that we need to consider around access to cultural opportunities?
Donald Cameron.
Thank you. And I absolutely do agree with that. And it was very clear when we visited Dumfries, which Mr. Beebe did with myself and others, that rural transport in particular was an issue and a barrier. We also consider the role of the planning system in protecting cultural and community assets, with the welcome inclusion of a new culture and creativity policy in NPF4. Local place plans have an important role in enabling communities to make their views heard on cultural spaces and assets. But the committee thinks there needs to be further capacity building provided to support communities to engage in the planning process and to embed culture in their LPPs. Presiding Officer, I'd now like to pick up on the importance of funding for culture in communities, which is a theme which permeates the committee's report. As mentioned earlier by the convener, the funding constraints in the current fiscal environment pose a significant challenge to the successful delivery of place-based cultural policy. Several organisations told the committee that their funding had been at a standstill for several years. This was underlined by Creative Scotland, who had previously told the committee that many organisations it funds on a regular multi-year basis have received unchanged levels of funding for a number of years, and that this is increasingly unviable as it represents an increasing year-on-year cut for organisations. Analysis by SPICE for the committee revealed that the total grant funding for Creative Scotland in 2021 to 22 was approximately 10% lower in real terms than in 2014 to 2015. And the committee heard of the impact of that on the ability of the sector to deliver cultural projects in communities. Caitlin Skinner, Chief Executive of Stella Quines, warned that the arts have been chronically underfunded and on standstill for so long it creates a limit on what is possible. The Federation of Scottish Theatre warned that organisations that are needed to deliver cultural work in communities are in an extremely precarious financial position. And as the committee noted in our pre-budget report published last week, we acknowledge the First Minister has committed to increase the Scottish Government's investment in arts and culture by £100 million over the next 5 years. However, we await the detail of how this funding will be rolled out in each of the next 5 years and how it will be allocated within the culture budget. And in this regard, I do acknowledge the comments made by the Cabinet Secretary in this chamber yesterday and the further information that he imparted about the breakdown of £6.68 million of Scottish Government funding. Can I, in the brief minute left to me, mention a few of the contributions heard today across the chamber? I think one consistent theme was the importance of the local grassroots development of culture and the importance of local people and their role in developing cultural services, and that was mentioned by many. Neil Bibby, Keith Brown, Sharon Dowie, Kirkup Stewart spoke about empowering communities and the identity of belonging. Many people spoke of their local experience. Colin Smith about his experience of the stove in Dumfries. Mark Ruskell, I think, rightly spoke of how important it is and how lucky we were to meet such a wide array of people and the scale of the challenge that they described. And he spoke of the opportunity in the Scottish Government's action plan later this year and hope that that plan takes account of the committee's recommendations. Audrey Nicholl made a very important point about community assets and spoke about, I think, a former police station in her constituency and also about culture in the justice space. Faisal Chowdhury spoke about cultural needs differing in Scotland and that Scotland being a diverse place meant that cultural needs differ from one community to another. I wish I could mention more, but I do not simply have the time, Presiding Officer. So in conclusion, the committee report clearly sets out the number of distinct and unique challenges that are currently facing culture in communities in Scotland: the squeeze on funding, pressure on volunteering, the affordability and availability of spaces for culture, and a lack of rural transport, which can all act as a barrier to cultural participation. We hope as a committee that the Scottish Government will now respond positively to these challenges to safeguard the future of culture in all our communities across Scotland. And I support the motion in the convener's name. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on culture in communities, the challenges and opportunities in delivering a place-based approach. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 11305 on committee membership. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 11153 in the name of Claire Adamson on behalf of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee on Culture in Communities, the Challenges and Opportunities in Delivering a Place-Based Approach be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And the final question is that motion 11305 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on Committee Membership be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. That concludes decision time, and I close this meeting.